This edition of the 10% Show is brought to you in part by Outlines Magazine, the voice of Chicago's gay and lesbian community.
Circus Vargas held a huge three-ring benefit for AIDS research, and the 10% Show was there.
Oh, and stay with us for Howard Brown Memorial Clinic's gala anniversary dinner that they call 15 Years and a Dream.
Combating and living with AIDS, it becomes a question not just of survival, but survival with grace and quality. Chicago House is a place where people with AIDS can live and function in a supportive and positive environment. The 10% Show was at the newest residence's opening.
This is the third residence, correct?
That is correct. We have two other residences that are currently in operation, and we'll be opening this for residents in approximately a week.
That's great. Now, you've been chairman of the board of directors the entire tenure of the organization?
No, this is also our fourth anniversary party. I've been chairman of the board for just a little over 2 years.
How do you identify these houses in these neighborhoods?
What do you mean by identify?
In terms of finding the real estate, the property, and the process that you go through.
We have looked for what we need in a facility. In other words, what kind of a building would be best. Because there are other buildings, one is a six flat and one is a two flat. And of course, this is a single sort of home. So we look and see what kind of facility we need. And then we take a look at what could be a reasonable neighborhood to look in. That's both from a viewpoint of accessibility of the volunteers, the type of properties, and the cost.
How many residents will be living here, PWAs, living in this facility?
There will be seven living in this facility, and this facility will be used for what we refer to as our 24-hour care. That is that we have a contract with Illinois Masonic to provide trained healthcare workers to staff this property 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, and everyone who will be here will need that kind of intense care. Now, if somebody comes and wants to have their own care provided, and we have had residents who've had insurance who've had their own care provided, they're certainly eligible and able to do that. They do not have to partake.
Program director, now, what really is your function with Chicago House?
What I do is I oversee the running of the three houses that we have. We have residence managers in each of the houses on a daily basis.
Now, the total number of residents, PWAs, living in the three facilities will be what?
Will be 27.
27.
Mm-hmm.
Do you have any other programs as they're, you know, in-house living that they do from a day-to-day basis?
We have two different programs within Chicago House. One is an independent living program and the other is a 24-hour care program. The 24-hour care program is our most recent, and that started in December of '88, and that's for individuals who are in the end stage of the disease and who need round-the-clock care.
Have you had a significant number of deaths in the past couple of months?
Yes, we have, in both the independent living and in our 24-hour care.
How do the other PWAs deal with that situation? What programs have you developed in order to take care of the grieving process?
We meet once a week with all of the residents, so they do have a time at that period to talk as a group with one another about it. They also spend a lot of time talking with the volunteers and also with the residence manager in the house. Okay. And with one another.
Okay. Is there a very close relationship between the resident manager and the PWAs?
By and large, yes, very close.
Okay. The racial breakdown of PWAs, what is it? Are you aware of that?
I'm not sure what exactly it is, but it's about 44% black, I think 46% white, and 15 or 16% Hispanic.
What do you find so interesting about PWAs living in a residential setting as opposed to being an inpatient in a hospital setting?
Well, I think that particularly in the 24-hour care environment, which this house will be, it gives a more human element for the patients. It allows for a more normal existence. You don't have people running in and out of the room all day long, interns, nurses' aides, messengers. I mean, it's a very low-key environment. It's very natural. It's more like being at home.
Hey, can you kind of briefly tell us the evolution from the first house to the present one today?
Okay, the very first house opened in February of 1986 in Uptown. It was a rented decaying mansion, for lack of a better term. And there we instituted independent living. What we found very quickly, though, was that people needed nursing services, so we had to enter a contract with the Visiting Nurse Association of Chicago. People needed a lot of support services. We found that it was difficult to find volunteers who would do a lot of the practical support. People were willing to do cooking, but not too many people were willing to do cleaning. There are so many men in the gay community who don't do their own cleaning, they're not going to clean for somebody else. So those are services we've had to contract for. The second house, which was established in Lakeview, we received a 25% interest in the property from a PWA, David Sint, who was involved in the local Presbyterian for Gays and Lesbian Concern. That's a two-flat, houses six people, and that is where we currently have our 24-hour care, which will be moving to this house in Edgewater. The next house was one on the west side of Chicago that's in the Westtown neighborhood. It's a six-flat that can house 14 people and two- and three-bedroom apartments. There we've been able to take care of a variety of different types of people. It's a truly ethnically mixed group there. We have had women there because that way they can have their own apartment. We have had a couple, two lovers there at the same time. And it is that site we hope to bring in an assisted supervised care setting later this year for those who are impacted by dementia, for those who are visually impaired from CMV, for those who need some sort of respite care. And then there is this house, the house in Edgewater, which is newly renovated. We plan to move our 24-hour care facility here. The rooms are much larger. There are seven bedrooms here, which gives us one more person for 24-hour care.
Much assistance from the federal government?
Not from the federal government at all. There's some pass-through money, which comes through the Department of Human Services. It's Stuart McKinney homeless money for corporate shelters. And we get about $125,000 a year from that.
Well, in the future, what do you see the role of Chicago House?
I think there's going to be a need for Chicago House in the years to come. Probably more of the line of the assisted living program that we're going to have at this house here. 24-hour care is something that is the type of referral that we're getting. Those who are able to take care of themselves in an independent living setting, we're finding fewer of those. I think part of that is because a number of other organizations have sprung up over the last couple of years, groups such as Harbor Home, which can keep people in their own home. And those who need assisted living, those who have dementia, those who don't have family support, or of a limited nature family support, they cannot take care of somebody either emotionally or economically, will fall back on Chicago House.
There might be some individuals in the audience that would care to get further information or maybe even become caregivers themselves. Could you please give us a number where they could contact you for further information?
Sure. Our main office number is 248-5200.
I'm proud to live in this great free country, and I'm proud of our commitment to free speech, and I'm proud of our country's commitment to protecting the rights of its citizens to work and live free from bigotry and violence. That's why I was amazed to discover that many people die each year in anti-gay attacks, and thousands more are left scarred emotionally and physically. Bigotry has no place in this great nation, and violence has no place in this world, but it happens. Prejudice hurts, kills. Please don't be a part of it.
In the last of its kind show stopping under the big top bravado, Circus Vargas rolled its wagons and dancing bears into Chicago recently. Ringmaster Clifford Vargas organized and orchestrated a huge benefit to help the war against AIDS.
Thank you. 10% Show, like all women.
Work, work, work!
The setting is the plush and prestigious Four Seasons Ballroom. The players, a responsive and concerned group of women and men. The cause, Howard Brown Memorial Clinic. This event marked 15 years of committed health service to the city of Chicago. Their dream is replacing the nightmare of AIDS with hope and understanding.
15 years ago, a group of medical students and concerned citizens saw a need to address a specific healthcare issue in our community. Throughout the years, Howard Brown has met the challenge and growth of what now has become a most devastating disease. In the years to come, every healthcare facility, every hospital, and every support system like Howard Brown will be overwhelmed and taxed to the limit in dealing with this awful disease. Tonight, Howard Brown takes a moment to pause, reflect, and look back on the past accomplishments and to honor those who have contributed in some form or another to fight this pernicious disease. This is the 10% Show, and I'm Greg Lindemann, and we'll be bringing you highlights of this gala celebration. I have with me now Senator Dawn Clark Ness of the 4th District.
4th District.
How are you, Senator?
I'm fine. Having a lovely evening.
Yes, it's a great evening, a great evening. People are having a wonderful time tonight. I want to ask you, you were involved in sponsoring House Bill and Senate Bill 100, which was the confidentiality bill.
Right. We were, a number of us were involved in helping to get that passed, 3 years ago now. And then we also had to face the fact that in one important respect, the law was substantially whittled away the next year by allowing doctors to test without any advice and counseling and written consent. And then this year, I sponsored a bill that would have restored that to its original form. And I was very pleased with myself. I got it out of committee in the Senate very comfortably. And then, regretfully, I lost it on the floor of the Senate.
Well, you know, I was amazing how many people don't know or were not aware of the fact that they can go into their doctor's office and get and have this test taken and not be made aware.
That's right, that's right. And that makes absolutely no sense. In fact, I was really stunned that we did not have more help from the medical society on something like that, because what struck me quite from our concern about it, which really was in terms of AIDS and the fact that you really want to get people tested, and they're not going to get tested if they know they're going to be breaching confidentiality. I mean, those are things that we understood. But even for people who didn't understand that, especially if they were in the medical profession, I looked at the thing that had been passed that one year, and I said, no doctor in his right mind would, or her right mind, would want to have the law that way. And so I was very surprised that we did not have more help.
We did not. In the future, the statistics are staggering about mayor's report on his advisory committee came out with statistics saying that by the year 1994, anywhere between 84,000 to 120,000 people are going to be HIV impacted, and anywhere from 16,000 to 19,000 people are going to be coming out with full-blown AIDS. How do you see that as obviously a burden?
There's no question. And something that's happened for a while, I think people were beginning to get some sense of the magnitude of the AIDS epidemic. And then it seems to have quieted down a little bit in the last year or year and a half. And maybe it's because no one likes to think about something that is that devastating for so long. But I think the fact that this is still with us and still enormous in its implications, even if you don't have compassion for all of the people who are going to be suffering from AIDS, and that's where we ought to start. Just the medical cost, the cost to society of the number of people who are going to have to be treated and cared for is really just staggering, which is one reason, I think, why we all have to think of ways in which PWAs can be helped without only acute hospitals and the more traditional medical facilities.
I am here with Larry Deuss and Gita, how do you say your last name?
Gita Gidwani.
Gita Gidwani. They are from DIFA. Tonight they received an award from the Howard Brown Association. And Larry, I want to ask you, what exactly is DIFA and what does it stand for?
DIFA is the Design Industries Foundation for AIDS. What we do is we are fundraisers exclusively, and we grant monies to the service providers, such as Howard Brown Memorial Clinic. DIFA is an organization that started about 5 years ago in New York, has spread across the country, and now has a very prominent chapter here in Chicago. We're lucky enough to have designers, major designers in the city, all working together, as well as other design-related community people, people from graphic design, architects, etc., who are also working with us to raise the kind of funds that our service providers need.
How many people comprise DIFA?
We have approximately 200 who we call volunteers, not members. We are not a membership-oriented group. We're a volunteer group. Anyone who works on anything becomes one of our volunteers, but the hardcore group is 200.
I'm here with Alan Kahn, who just received the Friends for Life Award from the Howard Brown Clinic here at the dinner. And Alan, I want to ask you how you got started in the in working with AIDS patients.
In the Newtown area, of course, quite a bit of quite a few customers of mine were members of the homosexual community. And we became friends in professional relationship. When AZT came out, patients couldn't afford the drug, and I made provisions with carrying them on insurance. If it had to be, if they didn't have insurance, I would give them the drug until they made some other arrangements. I would work through various channels at Howard Brown Clinic that made arrangements, and then ultimately the home pharmacy program came through, where patients who had no source of income or very limited source of income was able to get AZT. But all in all, I've made it a practice of mine to give out drugs regardless of the source of money that a person had. If they had money, fine, they could pay for it. If they had insurance, all the better. If they had nothing, that's okay too. And
well,
that's what I did.
It's something that's going to become a big issue now, of course, in the years to come with the projections that they have set with the HIV impacted individuals, the increase there, the increase of people coming down with full-blown AIDS, the different drugs that are coming out on the market, the DDI and all that. I assume you're going to continue in our community to be a friend of our community. Alan, we appreciate your work and everything you've done for us. Your pharmacy is on Thorndale.
And Winthrop.
Thorndale and Winthrop. 1100
thanks. West Thorndale.
1100 West Thorndale. Alan, thanks.
Anyone can always count on me for whatever they need.
Thanks a lot. You're a wonderful person.
Thank you.
Thank you. I'm here with Judith Johns, the executive director of the Howard Brown Clinic, and we're wrapping up this evening here. And it looks like it's been a successful evening. It's a sold-out event, as people already know here. The awards were presented to some wonderful people. Judith, I want to ask you how you feel tonight, and listening to these accomplishments and sitting back and soaking all this in. How does it feel?
Well, it's kind of fun because I really do get to soak it all in. The clinic's been there for 15 years. I've only been there for a year. And a lot of the credit that I get is really due to a lot of work that people have done over the last 15 years, but particularly the last 2 years. And this event is fabulous. We never, ever, ever expected anything like this. And one of the best parts of it is that the mix of people that are here. There are people here from all segments of the Chicago community, and that's very edifying. We like that a lot.
It is well represented by a wide variety of people, which I want to ask you now. According to statistics that are coming out now, from especially from the Mayor's Council on AIDS, the statistics concerning the HIV impacted, that rate, what it's predicted to be by 1994, the PWAs, that's all going to be changing. It's going to be increasing. It's also going to be affecting a broader range of people, and rumored, or how they figure, a lot of adolescents and a lot of children. How do you see Howard Brown reaching out to all these people? I'm sure this is going to be a health problem, a major health problem that the country's going to have to deal with.
First of all, you have to remember that already a third of the population that Howard Brown sees is a group of people who are from communities of color, and I think people forget that an awful lot. We are a gay clinic, though, and we will remain a gay clinic. However, we have expertise and we have experience that people just can't learn in a day or two, and we would like to provide our services as a resource to other people. And already we do see families, we see heterosexuals, we see people who really can't find other places to go at this point in time. And as other services develop, we hope to be able to provide some nurturing, some consultation, and some resource to those people who want to meet the needs by communities that we really don't serve. And our commitment is to the gay population.
And well, it's certainly going to need it because the healthcare facilities, the hospitals, and a lot of changes are going to have to happen over the next few years.
That's right. And if you really want to be realistic about statistics, we're only halfway through the number of cases that we expect to see among the gay population, so it's not over for us.
All right. Judith, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Continued good work in
thank
the future.
You.
Thanks
thank
a lot.
You.
Bye-bye.
Thank you.
In addition to raising $100,000, the Howard Brown Clinic, its staff and volunteers, witnessed an outpouring of support from a concerned and understanding community. A community comprised of individuals and organizations that help eliminate the hatred, the fear, and the threat of AIDS.
Grunts, groans, and drags. It's DQW, Drag Queen Wrestling Night at the Bistro 2, where dangerous drags and femme fatales battle it out for possession of the coveted golden pump.
They're coming at you live tonight from Drag Queen Wrestling. Tonight, ladies and gentlemen, we have a little added treat. We have an interview with the current world heavyweight champion, Zula the Zebra Woman. Zula is just returning to action after a few months off being sidelined by a severe broken collarbone. She's defending her title against the former heavyweight champion, Misty Starr. Now, Zula is someone kind of special to me as I discovered her in the jungles of Borneo many years ago when I was still a manager, and I brought her to the United States and brought her on her current career. There are a few rumors in the DQW about a redheaded zebra child, but no one's been able to prove it yet, and Zula and me aren't saying anything. Zula, do you have any comments tonight about tonight's match against Misty Starr? She says she's going to get the title back.
Well, you know, missing over here, Misty Starr, she says that she is going to, like, kick my behind. And I say to her that she is like the biggest, fattest pig I ever seen in the entire world, and that she needs not, like, kick my behind, but she needs to, like, throw her legs up in the air and grab an apple in her mouth, because she's a horrible person. Back to you.
I know there's a little bad blood between you and Misty Starr, but you have to give her credit. She was the heavyweight champion before you, Zula. You did get the belt from her, and you hold it right now. So you have to give her credit as some kind of a wrestler, other than the weight factor aside.
Well, you know what? She cheats. Her weight factor is, yes, a big contributor over it, because she is. She is so fat. And she throws me around, and she loves it very much doing it that way. But I am an outclassed wrestler by her. You know, as a matter of fact, you picked me up from the jungle. We are not talking about, like, the streets of Chicago. We're talking to the jungle. And you picked me up from the jungle, and we come out and we wrestle pigs like her, boars, the Borneo boar, you know what I'm saying to you. And look at her. Look at her. You can see. She is the fattest, ugliest pig I have ever seen in my entire life. I wrestle her, and I kill her. That's it.
Well, I have to tell you, Zula, Misty is real popular with the audience. Now, you've always kind of been the one that the audience doesn't really care for, And Misty's always been like real popular, and she's gotten all the applause. And there's a lot of conjecture tonight that she might get the title back.
Well, it is not easy being famous, you know, and it is not, she runs around and tries to be like the big bitch she is, but that's all she is, she's big.
Well, she does have some wrestling ability because she wouldn't have gotten to the top. You know, my sympathies are with you because I did manage you and we've been through a lot, and now that I'm out of managing and into announcing. But she still is a formidable wrestler, and you're going to have to defend the title. Now, when the referee comes down and it's 1, 2, 3, who's going to be on the top and who's going to be on the bottom and whose shoulders are going to be pinned, that's going to be the big question tonight. And the heavyweight championship of the world for drag queen wrestling
is right here in my hands, and that's where it stays. Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, this is going to be your main event. Thank you.
Hello, gang. Here we are. I'm Memory Lane with one of the Misty stars, with the fabulous Misty star, the only one and only. Misty, now, we were just watching Zula, the Zebra Woman, moments ago. Tell me, what do you think of the allegations of the Tubadoo and the Fatso calling?
Well, that's not our problem right now. No one knows Zula, the Zebra Woman, better than us. I wrestled her, my manager, Vinny Testosterone. She managed her. We wrestled. We know everything about her. That's not our problem. Right now, what we want to discuss is Diesel Debbie Lynn. She's the one that's causing the problems around here. She's the one that wants this belt. If she wants it, come and get it, baby.
Now, wait a minute. You're just going to let that Zula the Zebra Woman take over with all those nasty comments? She made awful comments about you, you know, being heavy and like a pig and all that stuff. Tell us about that. Your viewers, your fans want to know.
That's not the problem. We got the master plan, right? Master plan? We have the master,
the force.
The force is here, and it is us. My new manager, the Italian Stallion, me. This is what Diesel Debbie's got coming, honey.
Ooh. I can smell it, too.
From me.
Oh, now tell me about your new manager. When did you get the new manager, the Italian Stallion?
Well, I've always wanted the best, and now I have it, the Italian Stallion.
Where did she come from? Go ahead, dear. Where did you come from now, Italian Stallion?
I came from Italy. What do you think?
Oh, I'm sorry.
All right, we've said enough. We've got better things to do.
We'll talk. Well, goodbye. Thank you.
Oh, let's see what you know.
Diesel Debbie Lynn, as you can see, she is quite a diesel. Diesel, dear, what do you think of all the allegations that Misty Starr has made? Are you going to kill her in the ring? What are you going to do to her, girl?
I think she's full of it. Talks cheap and actions speak louder than words. You know how long I've been here in the DQW, and you know what I've done. First match, took the world tag team belts. That's lasted for 2 years. The only reason the belts aren't around the waist now is because I'm a singles wrestler and I'm after the world heavyweight championship. And I will go through anybody I have to get it. Tina the Terror's out of wrestling. Broken arm, thanks to yours truly. Zula the Zebra Woman was out for 2 months. Broken collar, who do you think did that? Now, all that's in my way is Misty Star. I'm gonna go through her like a freight train, and I'm gonna get Zula's belt. I don't care who I have to wrestle, the referee, the audience, it doesn't matter. I don't care what kind of match, I want her. And she's gotta deal with this.
You are one wildcat. Why, you knocked the microphone cord right off here. So I guess it's not important.
But if she thinks any talk in the world is going to make me just lay over and die, she's got another thing coming. Take a look at these eyes. Do these eyes look like I'm here to play? This ain't fun and games. This is wrestling. I'm in it for the money, and I'm in it to kill.
Those are eyes I wouldn't want to meet up in a dark alley with, dear. Now, what about, what are you going to break of hers? What are you going to break of Misty Stars? Is there any particular area of her body that you're going to go for first?
Yeah, her mouth. It's the only thing I have trouble with.
Oh, enough to scare me. Stand up once and show the audience just how big you really are, girl.
6'2", 267 pounds. Nobody can take this girl and nobody ever will.
Okay, wow.
What do you think? Think she can handle it? Think anybody can handle it?
Like I said, folks, this, oh my God, there she goes. She's coming toward the screen. She's out of control.
Tour of the Far East. She's been successful in Japan and China, which probably explains for her change of outfit. Well, Mildred has a tough event tonight. She's facing someone who is very new to the DQW, but has been extremely successful. Helen Keller. She's only 78 and a half pounds, but there's 78 and a half very lethal pounds. Helen, Mildred, how do you feel about facing Helen tonight?
First of all, honey, I don't appreciate that Helen shit. do I look like I
correct
do
myself,
I look,
but I did apologize.
And you did correct yourself quite well. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Do I look like I weigh something 8.5 pounds?
In one thigh, maybe. On a good day. But go ahead.
Anyway.
She goes out.
Yes, I have been in the Far East, and I've been enjoying myself every little bit of inch of my little old self. Yes, I have. There we go. Well, you see, when I went out there, you know I'm a successful recording star now since I left ECW.
I wasn't aware of that.
Oh, yes, I am, honey. You've never heard of my new hit, Mama's Good Girl Gone Bad?
No, I didn't.
No. Well,
I would have sworn when you were turning Japanese, but what do I do?
Well, I tried, but it just didn't work out. Anyways, back to this match.
Yes, really. Now, I mean, what about this Helen Keller stuff? She's been undefeated thus far in the DQW, so she's definitely someone to contend with. So how do you feel about Helen Keller?
Does shit mean anything to you? It's kind of like cow shit on the bottom of a cowboy boot. I do not like the woman. The woman is ugly. She's blonde by bottle. And she has no taste in clothing whatsoever. You see here, I'm very, very color conscious and very, very, you know, into that Vogue style.
I hadn't noticed. But anyway.
Your mistake, not mine.
But she is undefeated. So now, what do you intend to do in the ring? Which is the bottom line.
Well?
I mean, she obviously does her talking in the ring, because she hasn't lost a match yet since she's joined us in the DQW.
The bitch is blind.
Well, what has that got to do with it?
What is... She's blind. She can't see. She smells...
Oh, blind. I thought you said...
I said blind.
You were saying blind. We know she's blind.
No.
You said blind. Well, here we have.
I don't have that much of a
problem. We definitely have a failure to communicate now, I'm telling you. Okay, so she's blind, but she's still one all of her matches. Now what?
Well, she's blind, you know. Blind.
I understand.
All she can do is smell. And I use that lady's speed stick, and she's not going to find me.
Oh, you don't think that should be a problem?
No, when I do get her in that ring.
Well, sitting over here, I can tell you it might be a problem.
I don't think it is.
I'm in trouble now.
Yes, you are.
Well,
anyway,
I have to be impartial. I'm just the interviewer.
Back to the rest.
Okay, here we go.
What I'm going to do is, I'm going to go in there. I'm going to act glamorous, as always, and very fashionable, and present myself to the audience, the public, very well, as always, of course. And then, I'm just going to go ahead and wring the fucking bitch's neck.
You're going to wring the hell's neck?
Oh my God. Yo, you bitch, don't try. Don't even start with me. Bitch, need a referee in here. I'm not going to stand around and stand here for all this bitch. You drop dead.
Oh.
Bad slob.
Ladies. I don't know, but Helen Keller looks like she's in deep stuff over here.
Yeah.
Hi, everybody. I'm Memory Lane. Here we are at the Bistro 2, and I'm sitting here with Ninja Housewife. It's Wednesday night, and every Wednesday night here at Bistro 2 is show night. Ninja, now tell me, how do you in the world did you ever use these chucks, these kitchen chucks? Show the crowd. Oh, ooh. Don't touch those chucks or she'll use them on you. How did you, oh.
I'm very dangerous.
Oh, boy. Oh, all right. Wow, those are amazing. Now, who are you fighting coming up here, Ninja?
Oh, policewoman.
Policewoman?
Yeah.
Are you going to club her with your nunchucks? Nunchuck?
No need.
You are?
Very dangerous. I break neck.
Now, is it true that one time one of your clubs came up and hit Tina Tech in the head?
Mm-hmm. That was fun that way.
Is that when she broke her collarbone?
No.
This edition of the 10% Show is brought to you in part by Outlines Magazine, the voice of Chicago's gay and lesbian community.